Hello and welcome to Health Bites, brought to you by Levitas Group. Our first episode of the series is going to focus on oral hygiene and the intricacies of that.
Hi, my name is Ash Kapoor. I'm the clinical director of Levitas Clinics and also the Levitas Academy. We run a regenerative medical centre as well as general practice. But one of the differences between us and the average clinic is that we have a dental unit. And as a consequence of that dental unit, we've been able to attract some very good dentists and affiliated practitioners like oral hygienists. And I'm very fortunate today to have Idalina with us, who's a very renowned oral hygienist and has a passion for her job. So today we're kind of going to be talking a little bit about how Idalina's world and our world in medicine have an interface. So welcome, Idalina.
Well, thank you for having me. This is a subject that is very close to my heart because as a student, every student had to pick a subject to either do their own research. And at the time, I chose to do a literature review on the links between periodontal disease and systemic health. So this is something for the last 22 years I've been very passionate about. And certainly at the moment, it's such a hot topic.
Fantastic.
How periodontal health influences systemic health.
Excellent.
So very excited about talking about this.
Periodontal health. Does the word periodontal mean everything around the teeth?
Yes, so perio actually does mean around.
Mm-hmm.
Dontal comes from the word dent, which is tooth.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, so the structures that support the tooth.
Right.
Okay. Essentially the bone, the gingiva, the cementum, and the periodontal ligament.
Excellent.
I hope I got that right.
Yeah, no, I'm sure you have. And so periodontal disease has impact on physical health.
That's true, yes. So, in fact, scientists now believe that most systemic disease is caused by one particular bacteria called P. gingivalis, which in turn produces chronic inflammation.
Wow.
That chronic inflammation produces toxins which travels through other organs in your body. And that can attack.
Of course, yeah.
So certainly in terms of heart disease,
mm-hmm.
that's there's a well-established link that gum disease affects your heart.
Interesting. Well, we in our world, we talk a lot about inflammation. Inflammation of the mitochondria, inflammation of the cell, inflammation of the tissue.
Mm-hmm.
And we believe every disorder comes from inflammation too. But I didn't realize that one bacteria was responsible for all of this. Is that?
Well, I was trying to find out who attributed the saying that the mouth is the door to your body.
Yeah.
So it all starts in the mouth if you think about it.
Yes, absolutely.
And if you're not maintaining good oral hygiene, then even though we have bacteria, everyone has bacteria in their mouth, good and bad, and it's about getting that good balance, meaning that it's important that you maintain good oral health. And so the bad bacteria doesn't accumulate to the point that it's going to cause inflammation, chronic inflammation.
Yes.
Because it's okay to have a bit of inflammation, because that's how the body, the immune system responds. But it's when you're allowed to let that be chronic, which will have a bad effect.
Yes.
So by maintaining good oral health, such as flossing, and I always say flossing first because you should floss first, and then brushing, we essentially are maintaining that equilibrium.
Interesting. Interesting. I mean, again, very similar to the world we're in.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about balance between good and bad. And acute stress is good, but chronic stress is not good. So same with the mouth.
You've put it such much more eloquently than people.
No, not at all. So flossing, brushing your teeth, how does that change the equilibrium? Does it get rid of the bad bacteria when you do these things?
So by flossing first, essentially you're removing the bacteria in between the teeth.
Yes.
Then you should follow by brushing, because research has shown that it removes more bacteria. So by doing that, you're ensuring that the plaque doesn't mature to the level that is going to cause disease.
Got it.
Therefore, inflammation.
Interesting. So bacteria sit in the plaque?
Yes.
I understand.
So plaque is a sticky tooth color layer of bacteria, essentially.
Yes, I wasn't aware of that. I thought it was just about having clean teeth, but if this is where bacteria hibernate and grow, then that makes complete sense. And what about mouthwashes? What are your thoughts on mouthwashes?
Mouthwash has a place in the oral hygiene regime, but unfortunately, sometimes I feel my patients misuse it.
In what way?
Well, often they brush and they use a mouth rinse, which essentially voids the fluoride from the toothpaste. So if someone is going to use a mouthwash, mm-hmm. they should be using it at a different time.
Interesting.
Brushing. So essentially, you should be brushing your teeth, well, flossing first, brush, spit, don't rinse. So essentially the fluoride stays on the teeth.
Oh, you right.
And then after, you shouldn't eat or drink for half an hour. Now, there's an interesting point as well. Most people tend to brush after breakfast. And that's, again, wrong. You should actually brush before breakfast.
Okay.
And that is so you remove the bacteria that has accumulated during the night.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have something to eat, bacteria is not there to interact with saliva and turn into its acidic environment.
Okay.
Then often people ask me, well, but after eating, shouldn't you be brushing your teeth? And I go, no, because if you brush your teeth straight after eating, essentially you are removing that layer of enamel that has been demineralized by the acid.
Right, okay, I understand. So you can aggravate a problem.
Absolutely. It's important that, like I say, if you're gonna use a mouthwash, maybe use it possibly after lunch.
Yes, or after breakfast.
Oh, after breakfast.
Yeah, interesting. Well, I didn't know that. I must say I'm guilty of rinsing immediately afterwards. I don't know whether it's an old wives' tale, but I've heard that in the morning, if you gargle with water and you then swallow, you're swallowing probiotics, prebiotics into the system. Is that true or not true?
I must say that is something I'm not quite sure, so I'll have to look into that.
Yes, well, it's just an interesting fact.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure if it's got
this. It's so important that as professionals we exchange information.
Yeah. So if I flossed, then brushed, and spat but not rinsed,
mm-hmm.
that would put my mouth flora in a good place. Super. Okay. So having done all of that, a lot of patients come to you mm-hmm. for a more sort of interventional treatment. So Hygienist type treatment,
mm-hmm.
and they feel so good afterwards. Is that necessary if we do this, if we do the flossing and the brushing properly, do we need to have anything else done?
Absolutely, because there's going to be areas in your mouth that's hard to reach areas.
Got it.
And that's where I come in. At Levitas, I'm very, very lucky that we have the guided biofilm therapy in place, so we have the equipment to follow the protocol. In fact, Levitas is a GBT certified practice. And what that means is that we're using the latest technology in terms of ensuring that when we're providing the hygiene treatment for a patient, we are delivering the best.
Interesting.
And what that means is that we disclose the biofilm, the plaque biofilm, so essentially the bacteria. So that way it's a visual for myself as a professional and for the patient, because it's easy for me to tell a patient, oh, you're missing this area here or there. But without actually using the disclosing agent, sometimes the patient find it really hard to actually see.
Interesting.
Where I'm pointing at.
Yes.
And since the bacteria is the same color as the teeth.
Yeah.
So by following the protocol, it actually becomes a less invasive procedure, because essentially I'm targeting the areas where the biofilm and the bacteria is.
You're not doing it blindly, you're doing it because you
think. Absolutely. So it's a much more effective treatment. Many patients find it less invasive as well, and painless, which is what
Yes, well, I must say, I've had it done. And I've had it done in the traditional way, and it is far less painless. And I have to say, having the biofilm on and seeing the dye colour change was quite frightening to see how much bacteria was sitting there, which I wasn't aware of. So I'm a great fan of it. Why aren't all dentists doing this? Why is it clinics like Levitas do it? Why aren't others doing it?
That's a good question. I mean, as a dental professional, I hope that in a few years' time, there will be a change where this is going to be protocol, because I do think that we have to move on with the times. And certainly, it's my belief that you should use what is available to do the best work and provide the best work. Obviously, it comes at a cost, and not every practice is able to afford the equipment.
But my feeling is, if we look after our teeth in the way you've described, we'll save lots of money later having the more expensive problems. Would that be right?
I mean, as you well aware, I'm a huge fan of the IOB toothbrush, which to me it's a game changer in terms of how it works. And it's that is something I recommend.
What's so good about this toothbrush versus the normal toothbrushes we buy?
The technology. And what I mean by that is that in the past, even the Oral-B has evolved so much. I mean, I've been in dentistry since I was 18. I'm not going to tell you how old I am now. That will remain a secret. For a long time, and even in the past 30 years, it's changed so much. I remember that when the toothbrush had the pressure gauge, that was like, wow. Whereas now, it actually has three light systems. One that is on, you can see it's working, but is the second light, which is green, which is telling you that you're applying the right pressure. And then red, you press into hard. Because in the past, when there was only the red pressure, it meant the patients were avoiding pressing too hard, so the light, the red light, wouldn't come on. But that, in fact, was it was not quite working, because then they were not pressing hard enough.
So either too much or too little.
That's right. So hence, I think it's amazing. Also, it actually uses artificial intelligence. So there's an app that you can download, and it will show you which areas you've missed.
Goodness, and how do they know? How does the app know what you've missed?
It's just obviously, I don't quite know the intricacies of it, but it's just all I know is I've seen it for myself, and even as a hygienist, it was quite eye-opening to see how it gives you a 3D image on the app.
Fantastic.
So it's really good.
Good. Well, before we enter the series of specific health issues and oral hygiene, just to summarize this particular element, the first thing to say is that we should brush our teeth before we eat. But prior to brushing, we should floss to allow the bacteria to loosen and then brush our teeth. We should spit and not rinse. And if we're going to use mouthwash, we must use it at a later date. Rather than straight afterwards. And the toothbrush matters in terms of how much pressure we push on. And despite all that, we should still see a hygienist using up-to-date technology to get to the bits we can't get to. And by doing this, we'll maintain a good microbiome in our mouths, which will avoid excessive bacteria going into our bodies, causing potential issues, which we're going to talk about in the next series.
Correct.
Great. Well, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Our next episode is on brain health, particularly Alzheimer's and oral hygiene.